Hey guys, welcome back to my channel. So today I wanted to react to Dr. Mike talking about Ehlers-Danlos Syndrome on his newest video. He literally put it out like an hour and a half ago, and the second I saw it, I was just so happy that he talked about it. So I'm sure you're not watching this, but Dr. Mike, thank you so much for bringing awareness to Ehlers-Danlos Syndrome. Hopefully some of the medical professionals that watch your channel will be a little bit more educated about it and keep it in the back of their mind when they see a patient present with some of the symptoms. I should say I'm not a medical professional by any means. I do have Ehlers-Danlos Syndrome, and I'm also currently doing research on classical EDS and hypermobile EDS, and I'm in the process of applying to programs in hemogenetics and genetic counseling to hopefully be able to specialize in genetic connective tissue disorders. Let's get to it.
Patient number three is a 35-year-old male that comes in with a chief complaint of easy bruisability. The doctor does a good history and physical exam and wants to rule out bleeding disorders. Does a whole set of blood tests only to find out that they're all negative. So they reassure the patient. Patient goes home without an answer.
So very often, people with Ehlers-Danlos Syndrome have completely normal blood work, and that can be really confusing because many people come in with joint pain and muscle pain, history of a lot of different injuries and tendinitis, but by just looking at their lab work, they look remarkable. They look very healthy, and that can oftentimes actually lead to doubt, and many times medical professionals may question the legitimacy of somebody's symptoms, or kind of start looking more at psychological causes. And that's not to say that psychosomatic conditions don't exist or that they're not valid, they totally are. But when it comes to EDS, it can be really hard to be told that your symptoms might all be anxiety or depression.
What should have been asked are questions about hypermobile joints, accidents, loose skin, and family history. Why? Ehlers-Danlos Syndrome.
To add into that, I would say maybe ask about joint pain and muscle pain, as well as some other symptoms that can come along with EDS, like GI problems and dysautonomia. It's also very interesting that he chose a patient who is male and that he chose a patient who came in with their chief complaint of easy bruising. So more females than males are diagnosed with EDS, but because EDS is inherited through mainly an autosomal dominant or recessive pattern, it's technically 50-50, but females tend to present worse than men. So it's interesting that he chose a male as the patient instead of a female, because I think the more classic patient would probably be a younger female, somebody in their 20s or teens. But again, I'm not a doctor.
It's one of those zebras that we always have to keep in the back of our minds. EDS is a genetic condition that affects the connective tissues of our body. This can include skin, blood vessels, bone, and even organs. Now, there's 13 different subtypes of EDS, but all of them have one thing in common, and that's hypermobility.
So I should say that the image that he showed is somebody who has extremely stretchy skin, and that is totally present in EDS, but some people don't have quite as stretchy a skin, and that is totally okay. In fact, some people who have hypermobile EDS have soft skin and velvety skin, but it's not even stretchy. For me, I have hypermobile EDS and I do have stretchy skin, but like compared to that other dude, like this is my stretchy skin and his would be like here, you know? But still a great image and it shows, you know, what he's talking about, but I should just throw it out there. It's not always that extreme.
It's really important when you're seeing these group of symptoms arise in a patient that you ask about hypermobility so it doesn't go overlooked.
And that's so true, because sometimes it's actually hard to connect your other symptoms to hypermobility that you've been dealing with your entire life. So the first dislocation I ever experienced was at the age of 8, and the first subluxation was at the age of 6 or 7. It was my left knee. As I grew up, you know, I kind of started realizing that there was definitely something wrong with me by the time I was like 9 or 10, because the number of injuries that I had and all this chronic pain that nobody else was dealing with at my age, nobody I knew at least. But it wasn't until I was in like my mid-teen years where I really started looking for something that could be wrong with me, you know, going to literally over 50 doctors to address the GI pain and joint pain and dysautonomia symptoms. But very few doctors connected my symptoms to my profound hypermobility. I always knew I was hypermobile, and I even knew that term because I'd been told I was hypermobile and had lax ligaments my entire life by so many different doctors, but I don't know why none of them really connected it.
In fact, there's currently no cure for Ehlers-Danlos Syndrome, but we can focus on controlling the risk factors and helping patients reduce their symptoms of the disease.
So some of the risk factors that he might be talking about are things like further joint injuries and repetitive overuse injuries, as well as some people do have some more dangerous comorbidities or symptoms. I mean, some people will have, you know, a dilation of their aorta. That's not usually what happens in most people with hypermobile or classical EDS. It's more common in some of the other types, but it still is present. And for some people, depending on what their doctor thinks, it might be a good idea to get that checked out.
Currently, it's estimated that 1 in 5,000 individuals in the US will be diagnosed with EDS. And classically, it goes underdiagnosed.
1 in 5,000 sounds pretty rare, or at least somewhat rare, and it is very underdiagnosed. While we don't actually have the numbers to say, you know, how many people have it, it's likely to be a lot more common than that. And if not Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, then at least a hypermobility spectrum disorder, where somebody has complications due to their hypermobility.
In order to make the diagnosis, we use a set of clinical criteria, genetic blood tests, imaging, and even skin biopsy at times to make sure that we are in fact treating the correct subtype of the disease.
Totally, because subtype matters so much here. You're not gonna treat somebody with vascular EDS the same way you're gonna treat somebody with hypermobile EDS. Also, clinical criteria that he's referring to. Of the 13 subtypes that he mentioned, around 80 to 90% of people with Ehlers-Danlos syndrome all have the hypermobile subtype of EDS. But that is the only subtype that does not have a known gene mutation associated with it. That is so complicated and confusing, and it can make it really hard to diagnose because they're solely going off clinical criteria. Now, if you're curious about what that clinical criteria is, I actually did a video on it a few years ago where I run through the entire hypermobile EDS criteria. So for that one, there is no blood tests. But then for the other ones, you can do blood, or actually I think you can also do saliva. It's just a DNA test to see if you have a mutation in, or a specific mutation in the genes that could potentially cause EDS. But the hypermobile type is not going to have a gene mutation because we don't know what that mutation is yet. But currently there's so many studies going on trying to find that mutation.
When we're talking about treatments, we're largely focusing on physical therapy, surgery to fix the injured joints, and finally drugs and medications that can help a patient with the symptoms of EDS.
Totally, physical therapy can be fantastic. Also, when it comes to surgery, it can be very hard to do that because one thing he doesn't mention is that there can be a lot of skin side effects of somebody who has EDS. So it can be really hard to heal. Skin or on the inside, anywhere, it can be very hard to heal. So sometimes when a surgery would be recommended in somebody without EDS, it may not be recommended in somebody with EDS. But then again, people with EDS tend to have a lot more orthopedic surgeries than anybody else. I mean, I guess I've technically had 2 orthopedic surgeries and I'm 23, which doesn't sound like that much, but like, you know, I shouldn't be having orthopedic surgery. Not due to like a traumatic injury, you know what I mean?
One of the most common misconceptions about EDS is that it must be inherited from your family. And while that is true for the majority of cases, because it is usually transferred in an autosomal dominant or autosomal recessive nature, there are de novo, meaning new mutations that can happen spontaneously where you develop EDS without any of your family members ever being diagnosed.
So what he's saying there that I want to comment on is, yeah, most types of EDS are passed on in an autosomal dominant pattern, and some are recessive, autosomal recessive. And so in that case, you, if you have both gene mutations, neither of your, and your parents only have one, for the most part, they're not going to experience any symptoms. It may not look like it's inherited, but then it technically is. But what he's talking about now is a de novo mutation, which is where it just spontaneously happens. And that is, you know, like uncommon, but that happens too. But something else that he did not mention, and this is again, like coming from the research I do on EDS, but again, not a doctor, is that depending on what the mutation is and where it is in the gene, that same gene mutation can differ dramatically between different people in the same family. So that's why sometimes you get a kid who is extremely affected by their EDS and the parent has the exact same gene mutation, but they just happen to be a little bit hypermobile and maybe bruise easily or something like that, but would never seek out a diagnosis of anything.
It's also important to keep in mind that there are other connective tissue disorders and hypermobility disorders that need to be ruled out before jumping to the diagnosis of EDS, but that is why it's really important that if you have hypermobile joints, elastic skin, or any of the symptoms I mentioned above, talk to your doctor, make sure that you're diagnosed correctly.
It is so important that he's talking about other conditions that can cause hypermobility. First off, up to 20% of the population, some studies say 10, but some studies say up to 20, is hypermobile, and it does not cause them any problems, and it's not bad. It's not a hypermobility spectrum disorder, it's not EDS. But then there are some people who have complications because of their hypermobility, and that hypermobility can be caused by a variety of different things. So sometimes that is EDS. Sometimes it's another genetic condition such as Marfan syndrome, Lois-Dietz syndrome, or Stickler syndrome, or there's a bunch of others too, that can cause hypermobility. Sometimes it can be caused by non-genetic factors too. More often than EDS, somebody may be diagnosed with a hypermobility spectrum disorder, which is where you have hypermobile joints and you have complications such as dislocations and chronic pain due to those dislocations, but you don't pass the criteria for EDS. But you can learn more about this on the Ehlers-Danlos Society website. But if you're experiencing any of the symptoms that he has mentioned, totally talk to your doctor. Don't freak out, you know, if you're watching that and you're feeling very scared about it. I wouldn't, but I would definitely bring it up to your doctor.
Do you know a zebra condition that I should be talking about? Drop it down below in the comments.
He also didn't talk about comorbidities, and comorbidities, conditions that come along with EDS, can be so common in EDS. And one of the most common ones is some form of dysautonomia, usually orthostatic hypotension or postural orthostatic tachycardia syndrome, which is also called POTS. Around half of people with hypermobile EDS have POTS. Overall, I think Dr. Mike did a fantastic job talking about EDS. It's just fantastic to hear a medical professional talking about it and actually seeming to know what it is. I know you might be like, well, obviously he's a medical professional, he should know what it is. But I think if you don't have EDS, then you won't understand how many doctors literally have no idea what it is. One doctor once told me, she was like, you can't have EDS. EDS only affects your eyes and your heart. First of all, it rarely affects your eyes. I mean, it can, but like it's not like that's one of the main symptoms. And like, yeah, it can affect your heart too, but like, that's not a primary symptom either. Like, that's just wrong. And it's like, I don't know how to sit there and correct the doctor. Like, you're actually just telling me wrong information, but I'm just like, okay, yeah, thanks, have a nice day. Like, and I've also just had doctors say, yeah, you know, sorry, I actually just don't know very much about it. And that's totally okay. I'd rather have a doctor tell me that than pretend like they know about it. And then they sit there and, tell you things that are wrong, such as that first doctor I mentioned. Thanks for watching, and thanks again to Dr. Mike for talking about Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. Maybe one day you want to talk about postural orthostatic tachycardia syndrome or dysautonomia. Anyway, see you guys later. Bye.